The Drunkard by Frank O'Connor. It was a terrible blow to Father when Mr. Dooley on the terrace died. Mr. Dooley was a commercial traveler of two sons in the Dominicans and a car of his own, so socially he was miles ahead of us. But he had no false pride. Mr. Dooley was an intellectual, and like all intellectuals, the thing he loved the best was conversation. And in his own limited way, Father was a well-read man and could appreciate an inimitable intelligent talker. Mr. Dooley was remarkably intelligent. Between business acquaintances and clerical contacts, there was very little he didn't know about what went on in town, and evening after evening he crossed the road to our gate to explain to Father the news behind the news. He had a low, palavering voice and a knowing smile, and Father would listen in astonishment, giving him a conversational lead now and again, and then stump triumphantly into Mother with his face aglow and ask, "Do you know what Mr. Dooley is after telling me?" Ever since when somebody had given me some bit of information off the record, I have found myself on the point of asking, "Was it Mr. Dooley who told you that?" Till I actually saw him laid out in his brown shroud of the rosary beads entwined between his waxy fingers, I did not take report of his death seriously. Even then, I felt there must be a catch, and some summer evening Mr. Dooley must reappear at our gate to give us the lowdown on the next world. But Father was very upset, partly because Mr. Dooley was about one age with himself. A thing that always gives a distantly personal turn to another man's demise. Partly because now he would have no one to tell him what dirty work was behind the latest scene at the corporation. You could count on your fingers the number of men in Blarney Lane who read the papers that Mr. Dooley did, and none of these would have overlooked the fact that Father was only a laboring man. Even Sullivan, the carpenter, a mere nobody, thought he was a cut above Father. It was certainly a solemn event. 2:30 to the Cora, Father said meditatively, putting down the paper. "But you're not thinking of going to the funeral?" Mother asked in alarm. "'Twould be expected," Father said, scenting opposition. "I wouldn't give it to say to them." "I think," said Mother with suppressed emotion, "it will be as much as anyone will expect if you go to the chapel with him." Going to the chapel, of course, was one thing, because the body was removed after work, but going to a funeral meant the loss of a half day's pay. "The people hardly know us," he added. "God between us and all harm," Father replied with dignity. "We'd be glad if it was our own turn." To give Father his due, he was always ready to lose a half day for the sake of an old neighbor. It wasn't so much that he liked funerals as that he was a conscientious man who did as he would be done by, and nothing could have consoled him so much for the prospect of his own death as the assurance of a worthy funeral. And to give Mother her due, it wasn't a half day's pay he begrudged, badly as we could afford it. Drink, you see, was Father's great weakness. He could keep steady for months, even years at a stretch, and while he did, he was as good as gold. He was first up in the morning and brought the mother a cup of tea in bed, stay at home in the evenings and read the paper, saved money and bought himself a new blue Sergei suit and a bowler hat. He laughed at the folly of men who, week in, week out, left their hard-earned money with the publicans, and sometimes, to pass an idle hour, he took pencil and paper and calculated precisely how much he saved each week through being a teetotaler. Being a natural optimist, he sometimes continued his calculation for a whole span of his prospective existence, and the total was breathtaking. He would die worth hundreds. If I had only known it, this was a bad sign, a sign he was becoming stuffed up with spiritual pride, and imagining himself better than his neighbors. Excuse me. Sooner or later, the spiritual pride grew till it called for some sort of form of celebration. Then he took a drink. Not whiskey, of course. Nothing like that. Just a glass of some harmless drink like lager beer. That was the end of Father. By the time he had taken the first, he had already realized that he had made a fool of himself. It took a second to forget it, and a third to forget that he couldn't forget, and at last came home reeling drunk. From this on, it was the drunkard's progress, and in a moral prince. Next day, he stayed in from work with a sick head, while mother went off to make excuses at the works. And inside a fortnight, he was poor and savage and despondent again. Once he began and drank steadily through everything down to the kitchen clock. Mother and I knew all the phases and dreaded all the dangers. Funerals were one. "I have to go to Dumfries to do a half day's work," said Mother in distress. "Who's to look after Larry?" "I'll look after Larry," Father said graciously. "The little walk will do him good." There was no more to be said, for we all knew I didn't need anyone to look after me, and I could quite well have stayed at home and looked after Sonny. But I was being attached to the party to act as a brake on Father. As a brake, I had never achieved anything, but Mother still had great faith in me. Next day, when I got home from school, Father was there before me and made a cup of tea for both of us. He was very good at tea, but too heavy in the hand for anything else. The way he cut bread was shocking. Afterwards, we went down to the hill to the church. Father, wearing his best blue Sergei and bowler cocked to one side of his head, the least suggestion of the masher. To his great joy, he discovered Peter Crowley among the mourners. Peter was another dangerous ignorant that I knew well from certain experiences after Mass on Sunday morning. "A mean man," as Mother said, who only went to funerals for the free drinks he could get at then. It turned out he hadn't even known Mr. Dooley. But Father had some sort of contemptuous regard for him as one of the foolish people who wasted their good money in public houses when they could be saving it. Very little of his own money Peter Crowley wasted. It was an excellent funeral from Father's point of view. He had it all well studied before we set off after the hearse in the afternoon sunlight. "Five carriages," he exclaimed. "Five carriages and 16 covered cars. There's one alderman, two councillors, and 'tis unknown how many priests. I didn't see a funeral like this from the road since Willie Mack the publican died." "Ah, he was well-liked," said Crowley in his husky voice. "My goodness, don't I know that," snapped Father. "Wasn't the man my best friend? 2 nights before he died, only 2 nights, he was over telling me the goings on about the housing contract. Then fellows in the corporation are night and day robbers. But even I never imagined he was as well connected as that." Father was stepping out like a boy, pleased with everything, the other mourners, and the fine houses along Sunday's well. I knew the danger signals were there in full force. A sunny day, a fine funeral, and the natural vanity and flightiness of Father's character. It was with the grave, with the sense of having performed a duty and a pleasant awareness that however much other he would miss Mr. Dooley in the long summer evenings, it was he, and not poor Mr. Dooley, who would do the missing. "We'll be making tracks before they break up," he whispered to Crowley as the gravediggers tossed in the first shovelfuls of clay, and away he went, hopping like a goat from grassy hump to hump. The drivers, who were probably in the same state as himself, though, without months of abstinence to put an edge on it, looked up hopefully. "Are they nearly finished, Mick?" howled one. Bald one, I'm sorry. "All over now, bar the last prayers," trumpeted Father in the tone of one who brings news of great rejoicing. Let me just adjust this. The carriages passed us in a lather of dust several hundred yards from the public house, and Father, whose feet gave him trouble in hot weather, quickened his pace, looking nervously over his shoulder for any sign of the main body of mourners crossing the hill. In a crowd like that, a man might be kept waiting. When we did reach the pub in carriages, were drawn up outside, and solemn men in black tires were cautiously bringing out consolation to mysterious females whose hands reached out modestly from behind the drawn blinds of the coaches. Inside the pub, there were only drivers and a couple of surly women. I felt if I was to act at the brake at all, this was the time. So I pulled Father by the coattails. "Dad, can't we go home now?" I asked. 2 minutes now," he said, beaming affectionately. "Just a bottle of lemonade and we'll go home." This was a bribe, and I knew it. But I was always a child of weak character. Father ordered lemonade and 2 pints. I was thirsty and swallowed my drink at once, but that wasn't Father's way. He had long months of abstinence behind him, and an eternity of pleasure before. He took out his pipe, blew through it, filled it, and then lit it with his loud pops, his eyes bulging above it. After that, he deliberately turned his back on the pint, laid one elbow on the counter in the attitude of a man who did not know there was a pint behind him, and deliberately brushed the tobacco from his palms. He had settled down for the evening. He was steadily working through all the important funerals he had ever attended. The carriages departed, and a minor mourners drifted until the pub was half full. "Dada," I said, pulling his coat again, "can't we go home now?" "Ah, your mother won't be in for long enough time yet, he said benevolently enough. "Run out in the road and play, can't you?" It struck me as very cruel the way grown-ups assumed that you could play all by yourself on a strange road. I began to get bored, as I had often been bored before. I knew Father was quite capable of lingering there till nightfall, and I knew I might have to bring him home, blind, saying, "McDelaney's on it again." I knew that my mother would be half crazy with anxiety, that next day Father wouldn't go out to work, and before the end of the week she would be running down to the pond with the clock under her shawl. I could never get over the lonesomeness of the kitchen without a clock. I was still thirsty. I found if I stood on tiptoe, I could just reach Father's glass, and the idea occurred to me that it would be interesting to know what the contents were like. He had his back to it and wouldn't notice. I took the glass and sipped cautiously. It was a terrible disappointment. I was astonished that he could even drink such stuff. It looked as if he had never tried lemonade. I should have advised him about lemonade, but he was holding forth himself in great style. I heard him say that bands were a great addition to a funeral. He put his arms in the position of someone holding a rifle in reverse and hummed a few bars of Chopin's funeral march. Crowley nodded reverently. I took a longer drink and began to see that porter might have its advantages. I felt pleasantly elevated and philosophic. Father hummed a few bars of the Dead March in Saul. It was a nice pub and a very fine funeral, and I felt sure that poor Mr. Dooley in heaven must be highly gratified. At the same time, I thought they might have given him a band. As Father said, bands were a great addition. But the wonderful thing about porter was the way it made you stand aside, rather float aloft like a cherub rolling on a cloud, and watch yourself with your legs crossed, leaning against the bar counter, not worrying about your trifles, but thinking deep, serious, grown-up thoughts about life and death. Looking at yourself like that, you couldn't help but thinking after a while how funny you looked, and suddenly you got embarrassed and wanted to giggle. But by the time I had finished the pint, that phase too had passed. I found it hard to put back the glass. The counter seemed to have grown so high. Melancholia was supervening again. "Well," Father said reverently, reaching behind him for his drink, "God rest a poor man's soul, wherever he is." He stopped, looked first at the glass and then at the people around him. "Hello," he said in a fairly good-humored tone, as if he were just prepared to consider a joke, even if it was in bad taste. Sorry, I lost myself there. "Who was at this?" There was silence for a moment while the publican and the old women looked first at Father and then at his glass. "There was no one at it, my good man," one of the women said with an offended air. "Is it robbers you think we are?" "Ah, there's no one here that would do such a thing like that, Mick," said the publican in a shocked tone. "Well, someone did it," said Father, his smile beginning to wear off. "If they did, they were them that were near it," said the woman darkly, giving me a dirty look. And at the same moment, the truth began to dawn on Father. I suppose I must have looked a bit starry-eyed. He bent and shook me. "Are you all right, Larry?" he asked in alarm. Peter Crowley looked down at me and grinned. "Could you beat that?" he exclaimed in a husky voice. I could, and without difficulty, I started to get sick. Father jumped back in holy terror that I might spoil his good suit, and hastily opened the back door. "Run! Run! Run!" he shouted. I saw the sunlit wall outside with the ivy overhanging it, and ran. The intention was good, but the performance was exaggerated, because I lurched right into the wall, hurting it badly, as it seemed to me. Being always very polite, I said pardon before the second bout came on me. Father, still concerned for his suit, came up behind and cautiously held me while I got sick. "That's a good boy," he said encouragingly. "You'll be grand when you get that up." But gore, I was not grand. Grand was the last thing I was. I gave one unmerciful wail out of me as he steered me back to the pub and put me sitting on the bench near the Charlie's. They drew themselves up with an offended air, still sore at the suggestion that they had drunk his pint. "God help us," moaned one, looking pityingly at me. "Isn't it the likes of them would be fathers?" "Mick," said the publican in alarm, spraying sawdust on my tracks, "that child isn't supposed to be in here at all. You'd better take him home quick in case a bobby would see him, cop." excuse me. "Merciful God," whimpered Father, raising his eyes to heaven and clapping his hands silently as he only did when distraught. "What misfortune was on me, or what would his mother say? If women might stop at home and look after their children, themselves," he added in a snarl for the benefit of the Charlies. "Are them carriages all gone, Bill?" "The carriages are finished long ago, Mick," replied the publican. "I'll take 'em home," Father said despairingly. "I'll never bring you out again," he threatened me. "Here," he added, giving me the clean handkerchief from his breast pocket. "Put that over your eye." The blood on the handkerchief was the first indication that I got that I was cut, and immediately my temple began to throb, and I set up another howl. "Wish, wish, wish," Father said testily, steering me out the door. "One'd think you were killed. That's nothing. We'll wash it when we get home." "Steady now, old scout," Crowley said, taking the other side of me. "You'll be all right in a minute." I never met two men who knew less about the effects of drink. The first breath of fresh air and the warmth from the sun made me groggier than ever, and I pitched and rolled between wind and tide till Father started to whimper again. "God Almighty and the whole world out, what misfortune was on me that didn't stop at my work? Can't you walk straight?" I couldn't. I saw plain enough that coake spiced the sunlight every woman old and young in Blarney Lane was leaning over her half door or sitting on a doorstep. They all stopped gabbling to gape at the strange spectacle of two sober middle-aged men bringing home a drunken small boy with a cut over his eye. Father, torn between a shamefast desire to get me home as quick as he could and a neighborly need to explain that it wasn't his fault, finally halted outside Mrs. Roche. There was a gang of old women outside her door at the opposite side of the road. I didn't like the look of them from the first. They seemed altogether too interested in me. I leaned against the wall of Mrs. Roche's cottage with my hands in my trousers pockets, thinking mournfully of poor Mr. Dooley in his cold grave on the curb, who would never walk down the road again, And with great feeling, I began to sing a favorite song of Father's. Vo lost to Manomi and cold in the grave. He returns to Kinkora no more. Wish, the poor child, Mrs. Roche said. Haven't he a lovely voice? God bless him. That was what I thought myself, so I was the more surprised when Father said, "Whisht!" and raised a threatening finger at me. He didn't seem to realize the appropriateness of the song, so I sang louder than ever. "Whisht, I tell you," he snapped, and then tried to work up a smile for her benefit. "We're nearly home now. I'll carry you the rest of the way." But drunk and all as I was, I knew better than to be carried home ignominiously like that. "Now," I said severely, "can't you leave me alone? I can walk all right. It's only my hand. All I want is a rest." "But you can rest at home in bed," he said viciously, trying to pick me up. And I knew by the flush on his face that he was very vexed. "Ah, Jesus," I said crossly, "what do I want to go home for? Why the hell can't you leave me alone?" For some reason, the gang of old women on the other side of the road thought this was very funny. They nearly split their sides over it. A ghastly fury began to expand in me at the thought of that a fellow couldn't have a job taken without the whole neighborhood coming out to make sense of him. "Who are ye laughing at?" I shouted, clenching my fist at him. "I'll make you laugh at the other side of your face if you don't let me pass." They seemed to think this funnier still. I had never seen such ill-mannered people. "Go away, you bloody bitches," I said. "Whish, whish, whish, I tell you," snarled Father, abandoning all pretense of amusement and dragging me along behind him by the hand. I was maddened by the women's shrieks of laughter. I was maddened by Father's bullying. I tried to dig in my heels, but he was too powerful for me, and I could only see the women by looking back over my shoulder. "Take care, or I'll come back and show you," I shouted. "I'll teach you to be let decent people pass. Fitter for you to stop at home and wash your dirty faces." "Twill be all over the world," whimpered Father. "Never again. Never again. Not if I live to be 1,000. To this day, I don't know whether he was forswearing me or to drink. By way of a song suitable to my heroic mood, I bawled "The Boys of Wexford" as he dragged me to my home. Crowley, knowing he was not safe, made off, and Father undressed me and put me to bed. I couldn't sleep because of the whirling in my head. It was very unpleasant, and I got sick again. Father came in with a wet cloth and mopped up after me. I lay in a fever, listening to him chopping sticks to start a fire. After that, I heard him lay the table. Suddenly, the front door banged open and Mother stormed in with Sonny in her arms. Not her usual gentle, timid self, but a wild, raging woman. It was clear that she had heard it all from the neighbors. "Mick Delaney," she cried hysterically, "what did you do to my son?" "Whish, woman, whish, whish," he hissed, dancing from one foot to the other. "Do you want the whole road to hear?" "Ah," she said with a horrifying laugh, "the world knows all about it by this time. The world knows the way you filled your unfortunate, innocent child with drink to make sport for you and the other rotten, filthy brute." But I gave him no drink," he shouted, aghast at the horrifying interpretation the neighbors had chosen to give his misfortune. "He took it while my back was turned. Why, what the hell do you think I am?" "Ah," she replied bitterly, "everyone knows what you are now. God forgive you, wasting our hard-earned few halfpence on drink and bringing up your child to be a drunken corner boy like yourself." Then she swept into the bedroom and threw herself on her knees by the bed. She moaned when she saw the gas over my eye. In the kitchen, Sonny set up a loud bawl on his own, And a moment later, Father appeared in a bedroom door with his cap over his eyes, wearing an expression of the most intense self-pity. "That's a nice way to talk to me after all I went through," he said. He whined. "That's a nice accusation, but I was drinking. Not one drop of drink crossed my lips the whole day. How could it be when he drank it all? I'm the one that had to be pitied. My day ruined on me, and I after being made to show for the whole world." But next morning, when he got up and went out quietly to work with his dinner basket, Mother threw herself on me in the bed and kissed me. It seemed it was all my doing, and I was being given a holiday till my eye got better. "My brave little man," she said with her eyes shining. "It was God did it. You were there. You were his guardian angel." The end.